Did you know that traffic lights at intersections kill more people in the US every year than terrorism, lightning, and shark attacks combined? Traffic lights, those ubiquitous devices that are supposed to make our roads safer and traffic smoother, are causing thousands of deaths and injuries every year. How can that possibly be true? Well, it turns out, after some digging, there's a lot to talk about here. So let's see if we can't figure this out together and see if there's a better way of doing things. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is sponsored by PDS Debt. Let's start with some context. A couple of months ago, one of my friends brought this up in passing, that traffic lights were killing drivers and pedestrians. And that kind of statement is going to catch your attention. How could something designed and engineered to save us possibly be doing more harm than good? I can't remember exactly how the conversation ended, but in my head, I knew I got to make a YouTube video about this. The first thing that crossed my mind was, okay, let's say it's true. How do you prove it? I knew we had to look for statistics and crashes, and what I found was pretty shocking. The first thing I saw was that the US is a world leader when it comes to traffic-related fatalities. We're number one. There are roughly 43,000 deaths by traffic accident in the US every year. That's about 120 deaths every single day, for an average of 129 deaths per million of population. With the exception of China, that's the highest rate in the industrialized world. That's almost 5 times higher than the UK. Heck, it's even worse than Russia. And if you've ever seen those videos on Instagram and TikTok, you know how bad driving in Russia can be. And of all of those deadly crashes, about 1 in 4 happens at intersections, 10,600. Now this kind of does make sense. Even though they make a small fraction of all roadways, intersections are where you're most likely to hit another car head on or get hit from the side, making it more dangerous. It's also where pedestrians and bicyclists usually cross the road and have a higher risk of running into a car. So, as an engineer, the next question has to be, how many of those 10,600 deaths happen at intersections with and without traffic lights? That's the $64,000 question. And after digging around a little bit, I found that roughly 7,000 deaths involved unsignaled intersections, while only about 3,000 involved signaled ones, aka intersections with traffic lights. So then I thought my friend was wrong. It looks like signaled intersections are actually safer, less deaths than the ones that aren't. It seems like traffic lights are saving us and not the other way around. But unfortunately, there's a catch. But whenever you have raw numbers, you have to try to normalize it, right? Because how many intersections in the US are signaled and how many are unsignaled? Well, I researched that and I figured it out. There are about 3 million unsignaled intersections, right? That means yield signs or stop signs, two-way, four-way, versus only 300,000 intersections with a traffic light. That means that there are 10 times more unsignaled intersections than signaled ones. So then if you normalize the data, right, between the two, that for every 1 million unsignaled intersections, there are about 2,300 deaths per year. But there are 10,000 deaths per year for signaled intersections. So intersections with traffic lights kill drivers 4 times more than intersections without them. And the worst part was, looking at these numbers, traffic light intersections are particularly deadly at killing pedestrians and motorcyclists here in the US. So in the interest of being thorough, I had one more thing to check. What if we had the information backward? What if really dangerous intersections were dangerous, and as a result, people installed traffic lights and, well, they were still dangerous? But before we get into that, there's another problem that many are facing, and that's the debt crisis happening in the US and abroad. And I have some good news, because our sponsor, Purity Debt Solutions, has got your back. PDS Debt has customized options for anyone struggling with credit cards, personal loans, collections, or medical bills, even if your credit is bad. We all know how easy it is to get into debt and how the chips feel stacked against you when it comes to getting out. PDS Debt can save you thousands in interest and fees, and you can pay off your debt in a fraction of the time. They're a top-rated company on Google and have an A-plus rating on the Better Business Bureau. Many of the reviews actually mention PDS employees by name. They are passionate about this problem and are here to help.
So don't struggle and feel like you're alone, because you're not. Head over to pdsdebt.com/2bitdaVinci, take a free debt analysis. It's super simple, only takes about 30 seconds, and take the first steps to rising above debt. Huge thanks to PDS Debt
and you for supporting the show. So, traffic lights are the consequence of a dangerous intersection, an attempt to try to fix it, and sometimes they don't. But that would be really difficult to prove, because you would need data for a dangerous intersection before traffic lights were installed, and then data after they were installed. That isn't particularly that easy to find. But there is good news, because someone else already did the inverse experiment at a large scale in a town called Carmel, Indiana. Instead of installing traffic lights and tracking fatality rates before and after, they tracked fatality rates before and after swapping traffic lights for a different type of intersection. A low-tech, but highly effective solution I'll get back to in a minute, I promise. For now, just know that the experiment worked like a charm, proving that traffic lights are causing more crashes and not the other way around. So we can now ask ourselves confidently, why are traffic lights killing people, pedestrians in particular? I found many possible reasons, some stronger than others. Americans drive a lot more than people in other countries. More driving means more exposure to traffic risk, especially at intersections where vehicles interact with pedestrians and other vehicles. But driving more isn't the only reason why intersections in America are so dangerous. Other factors contribute to the problem, such as the type of vehicles, the design of the road, and the behavior of the drivers. In America, we love big, powerful, and fast cars, especially SUVs that combine the features of a car and a truck. SUVs are very popular here in the US, and they account for 46% of all new car sales in the country in 2022. But SUVs are also very dangerous, especially for pedestrians. They're more than twice as likely to kill a pedestrian than a car in a crash because you get hit on the chest and sometimes pulled underneath, whereas a car that's lower to the ground often will have you get flung onto the windshield where you roll out of the way. There's other considerations too. The weight of the SUV is always higher, which means more momentum, more energy coming into a collision, and finally, worse performance in terms of braking, taking all that mass and coming to a stop in time. The biggest factor in terms of driver behavior with traffic lights is something that we can all relate to if we drive cars, which is while they're made to keep us safer by turning from red, yellow, and green, yellow meaning slow down, come to a stop because we're about to turn red, oftentimes it does the exact opposite. Suddenly, when you know the light is turning yellow and you don't want to be late for work or dropping off your kid, you speed up. And others are seeing their light turn green while you're trying to rush through the intersection. That really is at the heart of this problem. It's a bad incentive structure. In 2010, 1,053 people, 57 of them pedestrians, lost their lives in traffic accidents involving red lights. And road design also plays a major role. In the US, roads are designed to accommodate high-speed traffic and large vehicles, which makes them less safe and less friendly for pedestrians or cyclists. But how on earth could you possibly redesign an intersection to make it safer? The Federal Highway Administration knows full well how dangerous intersections are, and they've designed multiple different types of intersections, like all-way stop intersections with stop signs on all corners, median U-turn intersections with bikeways and enhanced mid-block crossing, intersections with separate bike lanes or with side paths, and many more. The main goal of all these designs is to reduce the three main risk factors for collision. Conflict points, which are points where traffic merges or intersects when doing a left turn. Vehicle speed and collision angle. On a traditional intersection of two-lane roadways, there are a total of 32 potential conflict points where you could crash or hit a pedestrian. Now, some of those intersection designs that we mentioned are huge because they can cut the conflict points in half to 16. But there is one intersection design that rules them all, pun intended. Enter the roundabout. A roundabout is a circular intersection where traffic flows counterclockwise around a center island, at least for right-hand drive countries. Traffic approaching the roundabout yields to traffic already in the circular roadway. The roundabout is an impressively simple and elegant solution to intersections of all shapes and sizes. In a roundabout, since traffic flows counterclockwise, the central island is always to the left, so there are no left-hand turns. The opposite is also true for countries like India and the UK, where you drive on the left side of the road. Everything just gets flipped. The total number of conflict points or potential points of collision in a four-lane roundabout reduces from 32 to just 8. And that is a huge reduction in the conflict points. Furthermore, you always enter a roundabout at an angle from the right. There's no right angle collisions unless you aim straight at the central island. But beyond that, having a central island right in front of you and having to negotiate with other drivers to enter the central ring forces you to drive slower and to make more eye contact and to just generally be more aware of your surrounding. Now you're just a single fish in a school. You have to kind of play nicely with others. So in essence, the roundabout tackles everything that makes an intersection dangerous, and it does it well. Remember, this is just a design feature in the roadway, not some high-tech traffic control device or algorithm. A roundabout works in every kind of weather, from hurricanes to snowstorms to droughts or anything in between. It doesn't require any form of energy, so it'll work day or night, even if the power goes down. How annoying is it when those intersections with traffic lights, where the power goes out or there's any kind of disruption, and they're all just flashing red? Now, that completely bogs down traffic. It's kind of a nightmare. So at this point in a 2-bit DaVinci video, you're probably wondering, okay, that sounds great, but what are some of the trade-offs? There's got to be something wrong with roundabouts if we don't use them, right? They seem too good to be true. Well, actually, they are very popular, just not here in the US. One of my favorite things in all the world is traveling, and I've been doing a fair bit lately. I was in Spain recently, one of the countries with the most roundabouts I've ever seen, and even India, where they're not as common as Spain, but pretty prevalent. Today, there are only roughly 8,800 roundabouts in the entire US. But in the UK, there are three times as many, over 25,000. And France has close to 50,000 roundabouts, even though both countries are tiny compared to the US. Fun fact, in the UK, they even have a roundabout appreciation society that dubs its president the Lord of the Rings and publishes a calendar with the best roundabouts of the year. Yeah. We do things a little bit differently here in the US. So what's going on? Why aren't we doing more of this in the US? Is there a big traffic light lobby that's trying to hold us all down? To be honest, that's a tricky one. But remember Carmel, Indiana, that we talked about before? Jim Brainerd was elected mayor of Carmel, and after learning about roundabouts, he became obsessed with them. He started a crusade to replace all traffic light intersections with roundabouts. Today, Carmel has 144 roundabouts and only 15 traffic light intersections in the entire city. It has more roundabouts than any other city in the US. Since they built roundabouts to improve traffic safety, they did their homework and tackled all the relevant metrics. And here's what they found. Roundabouts didn't reduce the net number of crashes, but it made them less dangerous. After replacing traffic lights with roundabouts, only one crash in 1,000 resulted in death. In standard four-way intersections, that number used to be four times higher. And in Y intersections, it used to be 9 deaths per every 1,000 crashes. Today, the average number of deaths in intersections per 100,000 people per year in Carmel is just 2. Remember, the US average is currently 12.9, over 6 times higher. So roundabouts reduce fatality rates by over 6-fold, at least from that one data point in Carmel, Indiana. Now, this is not something you normally do in engineering, but just for fun, imagine if we took what happened in Carmel and just expanded that to the entire US for a minute. That would mean replacing 272,000 intersections. Now, I know that's a lot, but bear with me. If we extrapolate the difference between 10.9 deaths per 100,000 per population per year to the entire country, we could save over 360,000 lives every single year. That's almost 4 times the population of Carmel, Indiana. I mean, you got to think about it. What is a life worth? And what is 360,000 lives worth? Okay, so now for the cons. Roundabouts aren't perfect solutions for intersections. They do pose some other particular challenges. As I mentioned a moment ago, roundabouts do lead to more non-fatal crashes that lead to property damage. Driving on a curve is harder than a straight line. So it's more likely for inexperienced drivers to hit the central island or run into the car in front of them as they're not really sure where they should be looking. But like we mentioned, even though there might be a crash, there's less death. They're not as expensive as building a traditional signalized intersection with all the post, light, control boxes, wiring, and maintenance. However, replacing an existing intersection with a roundabout can cost close to $2 million, depending on where it's done. It could potentially pay for itself in the long run, but it would set a city back quite significantly. Finally, they also take up more space than a traditional intersection, so you can't exactly retrofit one in a small city with narrow streets. That's probably why they had to leave 15 traffic lights in Carmel. But for every con, there are even more benefits to roundabouts. It seems counterintuitive, but roundabouts make for smoother, uninterrupted traffic. You don't have to wait needlessly idling your car at a red light, even though no one's coming. How infuriating is that? That's really where people start to get antsy and do the wrong things that get them into trouble. This doesn't just let you go to work and back home faster, but also saves fuel potentially and lowers carbon emissions. In Carmel, the 144 roundabouts are estimated to save drivers $2 to $3 million a year in fuel, since there are roughly 100,000 people there. That translates to a savings of about $100 per family per year, assuming one car per family. Not a lot, but it's still just an unintended benefit. And while there's no technical reason why roundabouts can't just spring forth everywhere here in the U.S., there are some public perception issues to address. Americans are just generally unfamiliar or uncomfortable with roundabouts. They don't encounter them very often. And it is a very odd experience until you get used to it. And in that same vein, change is just hard for people, right? If you're the mayor of a town that converts all your cities to roundabouts, like the guy in Carmel, do you really want to be on the hook if something bad happens or there's some rise in some kind of a rate? Most people don't either. There's just a sense of change is bad. Let's just keep doing things the old-fashioned way. And there's also somewhat of a conundrum for self-driving cars, since they have more trouble negotiating a roundabout than they would a traditional traffic light intersection. And if we're headed that way anyway, maybe we just wait, because self-driving cars will negotiate with each other and have much more safety regulations in place. And maybe this is a non-factor. But what do you think? Do you have roundabouts where you live? Would you be in favor of seeing them? One other really amazing side benefit is that when you have cities built around roundabouts, you have beautiful city squares. Like, for example, in Spain, it was a Christopher Columbus statue or other beautiful parks and places to sit. The roundabout becomes an iconic city landscape feature instead of a hideous traffic abomination. There's so much about them that I love. And after traveling as much as I have, I kind of like them. Will they work here in the US is another question entirely. But one thing is for sure, traffic lights sometimes can do the opposite of what they intend, and they are pretty dangerous. So be careful at traffic signal intersections. And don't forget to let us know what you think and where you fall on the great roundabout debate. All right, until next week, check out this video next. I think you're going to like it. I'm Rico Tupi Da Vinci. We'll catch you next week.